This video was sponsored by NordVPN. Get 70% off and a chance of up to 3 years for free by using the link in the description. The pufferfish, also called blowfish or fugu. In terms of the potency of its toxin, it is the most poisonous vertebrate in the ocean and the second most poisonous vertebrate in the world, after the poison dart frog. It is estimated that only a mere 1 to 2 milligrams of pure pufferfish toxin could kill a grown man. To showcase just how little this is, a single drop of water equals about 50 milligrams. This minute amount is enough to kill you or around 10,000 mice. So let's talk a little bit about this toxin. It is called detrodotoxin or TTX. It is named after the first group of animals it was discovered in, the Detrodontiae, or the pufferfish. Of all the neurotoxins, it is probably one of the most famous ones, frequently being featured in movies and TV shows. It is also one of the most powerful neurotoxins known, and is about 10 to 100 times more potent than black widow venom, and about 1000 to 10,000 times more toxic than cyanide when injected. Eating it is a lot safer, but it's still deadly nonetheless. If you had the choice between swallowing TTX or the same amount of plutonium, you would have a better chance of survival going with plutonium. But how does it actually kill you? Detrodotoxin is one of a few neurotoxins that binds to the so-called voltage-gated sodium channels. In nerve cells, these channels play an essential role in the process that allows the electrical nerve impulses our body uses to send information to be transmitted from one neuron to the other. By binding to and disabling these sodium channels, TTX prevents the conduction of these nerve impulses, which ultimately shuts down the communication between nerve cells and therefore the brain and the body. The fish themselves are immune to the poison, due to a mutation of the protein sequence in the sodium channels, but for most other organisms it is lethal. When consumed, a low dose of detrodotoxin typically produces tingling sensations and numbness around the mouth, fingers and toes, as well as a feeling of euphoria. These symptoms usually start to occur between 15 minutes to 4 hours after eating. Higher doses produce nausea, vomiting and diarrhea, breathing difficulties and irregular heartbeat, as well as a loss of motor skills and extensive paralysis. The paralysis will worsen to the point where the sufferer will become unable to even move a finger, all while being fully conscious. Death usually occurs after 4 to 6 hours, but in extreme cases after as little as 20 minutes, either due to paralysis of the heart or the respiratory system. There is no approved medication or antidote for it. In pufferfish, the toxin is concentrated mainly in the ovaries, liver and intestines, and to a lesser extent in the skin. Originally it was thought that they produced the toxin themselves. However, we now know that the toxin is instead produced by bacteria that they likely obtain from their prey, and that form a symbiotic relationship with the animals. This is supported by the fact that pufferfish born in aquaculture and fed on a TTX-free diet have no toxin in their body, can however become toxic once released into the wild. These bacteria can also be found in a variety of other marine and terrestrial species that utilize detrodotoxin, such as the blue-ringed octopus, parrotfish, sunfish, moon snails, several species of crabs and starfish, as well as some toads and newts, and these tiny marine flatworms that are one proposed food source of TTX and pufferfish. The levels of toxicity depend on the species, the habitat and the time of year, and seem to be at least in some form correlated to the reproductive cycles, as they are typically significantly increased during spawning season. This might be to supply the eggs with the necessary TTX doses to keep them safe from predators, but the toxin might also function as a sort of sexual pheromone for pufferfish. Experiments have shown that they are able to smell TTX in the water, so the increased levels could mean that pufferfish are specifically attracted to the most toxic partners. Large individuals have enough toxin in their body to kill around 30 humans. That's enough to kill a fully grown great white shark. With these levels of toxicity, there aren't really any large predators that can realistically use them as prey, at least not the most poisonous species. Even an adult killer whale with its 2 to 4 tons of weight would probably feel very sick for a day or two after eating such a pufferfish. You would need to be a large baleen whale to be heavy enough to not be severely impacted by its toxin, and even they might enter a trance-like state for a while. Dolphins have been filmed seeking out pufferfish for exactly this reason. They don't eat them, but they catch them in their mouth and use them as a sort of chew toy for a while. The small amount of toxin released through the skin is not enough to kill the dolphins, but it seems to make them incredibly high. It is plausible that for a blue whale more than 300 times larger, swallowing a pufferfish whole could have a very similar effect, but such a scenario is of course unlikely at best, given that baleen whales don't typically feed in the tropical coastal waters pufferfish are most commonly found in. This sensation of euphoria and the tingling of the lips and the tongue is also why pufferfish is considered a delicacy in many Asian countries, particularly in Japan. That and the thrill of eating something that could theoretically kill everybody in the restaurant. It's a bit like the food equivalent of Russian roulette, at least that's how it feels. Because of this, detrodotoxin poisoning is, and was historically, by far the most common lethal marine poisoning. Archaeological evidence suggests that the people of Japan have eaten fugu, how it's called there, possibly for more than 2000 years. Because of the inherent danger, its consumption was also banned many times throughout Japan's history, and even today, fugu is the only food the Emperor of Japan is forbidden to eat. Between 1886 and 1963, there were 6400 cases of fugu poisoning reported in Japan, of which 3800 ended in death. That's an average of over 80 cases per year and a mortality rate of 60%. Most of the deaths, however, came from eating the liver, which was and still is considered the tastiest part of the fish, even though it holds most of the toxin. Since the serving of liver was outlawed in 1984, the number of cases, but especially the mortality rate, has dropped significantly, down to 3% in recent years. In Tokyo, only a single person has died as a result of fugu poisoning in a restaurant in the last 30 years, so despite its reputation, it is actually pretty safe to eat when prepared by a licensed chef. Almost all of the roughly 40 yearly cases of pufferfish poisoning in Japan occur when inexperienced people try to prepare the fish themselves, which is, needless to say, extremely dangerous. But despite its deadliness, this little fish might actually save lives in the future. Detrodotoxin has been found to be about 3,000 times more potent than morphine, which makes it a very attractive candidate for pain medication, if we can find a way to release the toxin in a controlled and targeted way. Furthermore, because it doesn't cross the brain-blood barrier like morphine does, it doesn't have the negative side effects of opioids, most notably their addictiveness, which has become a major problem in the US and other countries. And because the effects of TTX cause no lasting tissue damage and are completely reversible with time, it could become a long-lasting, very effective alternative to morphine that could be safely administered for weeks or maybe months, and therefore could be used to relieve chronic and neuropathic pain such as chemotherapy-induced pain, which is one of the most common reasons that cancer patients stop their treatment early. With each pufferfish containing enough toxin to treat dozens of people, this tiny but deadly fish could therefore become one of our most important allies in our continuous fight against cancer. But there's another thing that we can learn from these spiky floaters: the importance of proper protection. Our privacy and anonymity are becoming ever more threatened in this day and age. There are a lot of people out there that want your personal information to figure out who you are, where you live, what you think, and how to take advantage of you. You'd be surprised how much somebody can find out about you just by looking at what you do on the internet, and how valuable this information can be. And it's still surprisingly easy to get, especially if you use a lot of public Wi-Fi. NordVPN makes this a lot harder. All the information that you normally just scream out into the world, like your IP address, your search history, and what websites you visit, gets safely encrypted and sent through one of their 5,000 servers, which makes your personal information a lot safer. Not 100% safe, there will always be that one dolphin that tries to use you to get high, but a lot safer. Beyond that, there are of course also a lot of quality of life improvements that NordVPN will give you. Like accessing geo-blocked content, such as Netflix, from anywhere in the world, accessing social media in countries where these services are banned, getting the best prices on hotels, car hires, or plane tickets by booking virtually from different countries, and getting unlimited free access to services and websites that have daily limits. It's just a very useful tool for everyone who spends a lot of time on the internet. If you use the link down below, or the promo code FACTSINMOTION at checkout, you will get 70% off and an additional 1 month for free when ordering their 3-year plan. And an additional 1 month to 3 years for free on top of that, because NordVPN is currently celebrating its 8-year anniversary. Thanks for watching!